Good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome everyone to our worship service this morning. We have gathered as the people of God to worship the Lord, the one, the true, and living God. This morning is the first Sunday in October, so as our custom is, we want to wish happy birthdays and happy anniversaries to all those who celebrate these occasions during the month of October. So, if you have a birthday any time during the month of October, please stand up. Oh. All right. Everybody else skipped town on you, Bill. Let's sing happy birthday. Ah, one more.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear friends. Happy birthday to you.
And I have to recognize one of the Morseberger children has a birthday too, so you weren't alone, Bill. Now, if you have an anniversary during the month of October, please stand up. All right. Let's sing happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, dear friends. Happy anniversary to you.
God's blessings, both birthday and anniversary people. During October. The October church newsletter is available on a table in the narthex, so everybody has a label on them, so pick out your October church newsletter before you leave today. This month is a special month in which we take up a special offering for our missionaries that we support, and we call it Christmas in October. It's a special offering giving this month, and it's sent to our missionaries so that they will receive this gift in time for Christmas. For those of you using our envelopes, there is a designated envelope for Christmas in October. If you don't have church envelopes, just designate in the check Christmas in October in the memo section, and we'll make sure we get it to that right to our missionaries. There are more information about our missionaries on the bulletin board, which is closest to the church office. And also, there's a smaller display in the narthex. So please check out the recent activities and ministry of our missionaries. Coming up later this week, this coming Friday night, October the 8th, we will have our monthly movie night, and that begins at 7 p.m. in the Bailey Moore Auditorium. We will also have a concert on next Sunday afternoon, October the 10th, at 3 p.m. here in our sanctuary. Please see the bulletin for more details. Now, I have two more prayer requests. One is an update, and one is a new prayer request. We've been praying for Lars and Oksana Specht. They are the children of an RE pastor, Mark Specht, up in Havre de Grace. Lars is fully recovered from COVID, and Oksana is improving with just some mild symptoms remaining. That's the update. The new prayer request is that John, who is Megan Jenkins' fiance, Lauren Jenkins, thank you. Yes. John, who is Lauren Jenkins' fiance, is hospitalized in Northern Virginia with a blood clot near his heart. So please keep John in your prayers. Our call to worship is from Revelation chapter 4 and verse 8. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Let us stand together as we sing praise to our God with the hymn, Holy God, we praise thy name.
Ooh.
Worship service continues on page 85 of the Book of Common Prayer with the order for Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Continuing on page 87 with Christ's summary of the law, hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith: Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it: Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. O Almighty Lord and everlasting God, vouchsafe, we beseech thee, to direct, sanctify, and govern both our hearts and bodies in the ways of thy laws, and in the works of thy commandments, that through thy most mighty protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, we beg you, grant your people grace to withstand the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow you, the only God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can humbly approach your presence through what your Son, Jesus Christ, has accomplished on our behalf by restoring our relationship with you and redeeming us from our sins. We ask your blessings on the ministries of Al and Carol Meehan and Gerhard and Grace Meyer. Fill them with the Holy Spirit and with wisdom and compassion for those they minister to. We pray for fruitfulness in their labors for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray for those suffering from cancer, for Ginger, Patty, Warren, Stephanie, and Joe. Bring healing to them if it be your will, and have mercy on them as they go through their suffering. We pray, O Lord, for all those who do confess your holy name under the stress of persecution. Give them holy boldness and compassion for all those who persecute them. And we realize, O Lord, how hard that is to be in prison and beaten and yet forgive those who mistreat you. Grant to them that they may always be ready to give a reason for the hope that is in them and to suffer gladly for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Heavenly Father, we also pray for those who are suffering from various other health issues. We remember in prayer especially, dear Lord, for John, Mark, Renata, Terry, Dan, Denise, Ron, Preston, Kathy, Mary Claire, Greg, Dorothy, Ernie, Hunter, Carolyn, Oksana, Donna, and Michael. Grant to them your merciful presence and provide for their needs physically and spiritually. We pray also, dear Lord, for Bobby, Betty, Ed, Shirley, Harvey, and Bill and Betty, who are recovering from surgery, illness, or accident. Be present with them and grant them patience and perseverance as they seek to trust in you. We pray for your peace and comfort for those who have lost loved ones recently. We beseech you, Almighty God, also to pour out your blessing upon the police, firefighters, and first responders in our land. We pray in particular for Dan, Tom, Jonathan, Brennan, and Hunter. Strengthen them as they persevere in the midst of danger, that they who protect our lives and property while they faithfully perform their duties may so serve you here that they fail not finally to attain your heavenly promises, all which we beg through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Amos, chapter 8, verses 4 through 14. Hear this, you who trample the needy, to do away with the humble of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over, so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath, that we may open the wheat market, to make the bushel smaller and the shekel bigger, and to cheat with dishonest scales, so as to buy the helpless for money and the needy for a pair of sandals, and that we may sell the refuse of the wheat? The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, indeed, I will never forget any of their deeds. Because of this, will not the land quake, and anyone who dwells in it mourn? Indeed, all of it will rise up like the Nile, and it will be tossed about and subside like the Nile of Egypt. It will come about in that day, declares the Lord God, that I will make the sun go down at noon and make the earth dark in broad daylight. Then I will turn your festivals into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. And I will bring sackcloth on everyone's loins and baldness on every head. And I will make it like a time of mourning for an only son, and the end of it will be like a bitter day. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine for bread or a thirst for water, but rather for hearing the words of the Lord. People will stagger from sea to sea and from north even to the east. They will go to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. In that day, the beautiful virgins and the young men will faint from thirst. As for those who swear by the guilt of Samaria, who say, as your God lives, O Dan, and as the way up at Beersheba lives, they will fall and not rise again. Here ends the Old Testament lesson. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is taken from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God, which was given you in Christ Jesus, that in everything you were enriched in him, in all speech and in knowledge, even as the testimony concerning Christ was confirmed in you, so that you are not lacking in any gift, awaiting eagerly the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will also confirm you to the end, blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here ends the epistle. This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord found in John chapter 11, beginning at verse 1. Glory be to thee, O Lord. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. So the sisters sent word to him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. But when Jesus heard this, he said, this sickness is not to end in death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified by it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, He then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him." This he said, and after that he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go that I may awaken him out of sleep." The disciples then said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover." Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he was speaking of literal sleep. So Jesus then said to them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Therefore Thomas, who was called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, so that we may die with him." This is the holy gospel of our Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ. Let us now confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed, and I ask you, Christian, what you believe. "I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us remain standing as we sing together the praise song, "Shine, Jesus, Shine."
Shining in the midst of the darkness, shining, Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Spirit blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence. From the shadows into your radiance, by the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine. shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. So our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. And mercy, send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light.
Open my lips, O Lord, to faithfully proclaim your word, and may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and Redeemer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. A number of years ago, Sarah and I were playing a game with friends, and my one friend didn't understand why I made that move. It didn't seem real intelligent to her. And she said to me, Cedric, what were you thinking? I'm sure we've at times thought that. It's a commonly a question that we may ask in our heads, but we don't often verbalize it. And the friend tried to cover it up. Well, I just wanted to know what you were thinking. But she tried hard, but we verbalize that, but we don't often say that to those we know well and love. Perhaps in John 11, Mary and Martha didn't exactly say that to Jesus, what were you thinking? But I'm pretty sure they probably thought that. The struggle behind the question really is sometimes, God, I know you care for me, but it's hard seeing that now. Why did you let this happen? I know God has broad enough shoulders, but I'm just worrying about my shoulders and whether they're broad enough and whether I can continue to trust in God despite this traumatic thing that has happened to me. Believers try their best to believe that God cares for them and loves them, but at times harsh circumstances chip away. And face it, the hardest struggle we have is what goes on right up here. We see this struggle in the book of Job, in certain psalms of lament. The book of Lamentations is God's people mourn during their time of captivity in Babylon. And in the last book of the Bible, curiously, saints who have already died say this to the Lord in Revelation 6:10. How long, O Lord, holy and true, will you refrain from judging and avenging our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Now remember, that's coming from saints departed who don't sin anymore. And they're asking the question, how long, O Lord, till you rise up? And so I say to you and me, it's not wrong sometimes to question. There's questions that come from unbelief, but there's also questions that come from sincere believers. There's nothing sinful about that. But let us mix that question with ultimately our implicit trust in the Lord. questions, doubts, complaints. The Bible is full of them. This passage in which Mary and Martha struggle with the death of their brother and the delay of Jesus coming is really the struggle of faith seeking understanding. It is not that Mary and Martha have walked away from the Lord, for they didn't. But they wanted help in getting through this tragedy with their faith in the Lord intact. We will hear more of Martha and Mary's struggles next week as they question the Lord. But we will seek this week to focus on Christ's care for both Lazarus and his sisters and his disciples as they hear of Lazarus' death. So my first point is Jesus' care for Lazarus and his family. Our passage begins by telling us that a certain man, Lazarus of Bethany, was sick. He lived there with his two sisters, Mary and Martha. John fills in a little bit more background on Mary, who had anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair. And so the family had a very close relationship with Jesus, for repeatedly it says in this passage about Lazarus, the one that Jesus loved. In John 11:3, the sister sent a message to Jesus informing him that Lazarus, the one Jesus loved, was sick. This request presents a need similar to that which we heard way back in John 2 of our Lord's mother's statement at the wedding of Cana. They've run out of wine. It's a statement, probably implied that they want the Lord to do something about it, act on it. But the requests, though implying our Lord's actions, doesn't dictate what Jesus should do. In this case, Jesus could have readily stood right where he was and say, "Lazarus, be healed." Jesus had already healed people from a distance by speaking the word, and that person was healed at that very moment, even though the Lord wasn't physically present with the individual. So Mary and Martha are not dictating what Jesus should do, but they wanted Jesus to know of Lazarus's condition. Rod Whitaker makes this helpful comment in his commentary, quote, "In these requests, we have a model of intercession that makes a need known to the Lord with humility and recognition that it is His will that should be done. Such humility and submission are key characteristics of true disciples." End of quote. Our passage goes on to say in John 11:5-6, "Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, so when he heard that he was sick, he then stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was." He loved Lazarus, therefore he stayed 2 days longer. We could better understand it if it said Jesus loved Lazarus, therefore he came running immediately to heal him. That would make sense. The alternative which doesn't make sense is that Jesus really didn't care about Lazarus, therefore he stayed 2 days longer. But notice the text says that Jesus loved Lazarus, therefore he stayed 2 days longer. He loved him, therefore he delayed. It is the blending of these two verbs. He loved, he delayed. That is a stretch for us. And face it, we know this story. So we got background information and we know how the story ends. Put yourself in Mary and Martha's shoes. Tell me they're not thinking, "Jesus, would you please get the lead out? What's the delay all about?" Jesus' love for Lazarus and his sisters teach us that our trust in God's mercy even in the face of difficulties, is well grounded. Even those closest to Jesus had to endure suffering. Augustine, a bishop of the 4th century, said this about the suffering of Lazarus and his sisters in his commentary, quote, "The one sick, the other sad, all of them beloved. But he who loved them was both the savior of the sick, nay more, the raiser of the dead and the comforter of the sad," end of quote. In our lives, we don't have a play-by-play commentary from God in heaven about why he delays answering prayers and why eventually he chooses to grant the answer no. It is hard when the heavens are silent. But this too is an aspect of our following our Lord, that we must make peace that God still cares for us. We must guard our hearts against the corrosive effects of bitterness, but instead trust in the Lord and keep following his will and commandments. And so when the heavens are silent, we plod on. God still loves us and he cares for us. He's told us ahead of time, in this world, you will have trouble. So he cares for us. We don't know his plan. As I said recently, I'm not even sure in heaven it ultimately would make sense to us because our understanding is limited. But we know that God loves us, and so we plod on, trusting in his care for us. Brings me to my second point, Jesus' care for his disciples. In John 11, 7 through 16, the passage pivots from the family of Lazarus to Jesus and his disciples as they discuss going to see Lazarus' sisters. The disciples are concerned about Jesus' safety, and ultimately, I think, also about their safety, since they're going with Jesus. John 11, 8 says this, "The disciples said to him, 'Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and are you going there again?'" Twice in recent chapters, the religious leaders picked up stones to stone Jesus because they believed he was guilty of blasphemy. The Lord is going very close to Jerusalem where he received these threats. Bethany, in fact, is only 2 miles from Jerusalem. So the disciples are concerned. Again, this is what are you thinking moment. Are you sure you really want to do that, Lord? He's going right into the eye of the storm. In John 11, 11, Jesus clarifies, yes, he is going to Bethany to see Lazarus because he is asleep. The disciples thought that Jesus was talking about literal sleep. Instead, Jesus is speaking of the sleep of death. And so him waking Lazarus up is forecasting and predicting his raising him from death. Sleep as a metaphor for death was common in the ancient world. And so in both the ancient world and in Jewish thought, it was common to speak of death as sleep. So why didn't the disciples understand this common usage? Jesus wouldn't need to go wake up Lazarus from a nap. His sisters can handle that. The disciples were bewildered, but they should not have been bewildered, which gives us encouragement. And when we are in the fog and don't understand things and we're not quite functioning with all engines going, God still has mercy on us. Jesus' long-suffering with his disciples is again a manifestation of Christ's patience, mercy, and grace. John Calvin, in his commentary, remarked about the disciples' dullness. Quote, Christ's kindness in putting up with such stupidity in the disciples was remarkable. John Calvin wasn't always tactful. But thanks be to God, the Lord is patient with us. Our Lord says in John 11, 14 and 15, "So Jesus said to them plainly, 'Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad for your sakes I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him.'" Since his disciples are not understanding the figurative use of the word sleep, he switches the literal language and tells them, "Lazarus is dead." He also tells them that their faith will be strengthened from his delay, as we will see later in this story, as he raises Lazarus from death. But the time for delaying has come to an end, and he now tells them it's time to go and see Lazarus. John 11, 16 ends with these words, "Therefore Thomas, who is called Didymus, the twin, said to his fellow disciples, 'Let us also go so that we may die with him.'" Jesus knows what is coming in the raising of Lazarus, and he is at peace, but Thomas and the other disciples are not. And what we have to understand about this gospel, John's gospel is unique. Because you might think, well, John 11 is only halfway through the gospel. Well, it is, but it's a little compressed. John 12 is the beginning of Holy Week. So when Thomas says, "Let us go to him to his death," yep, you're tracking right, Thomas. He is about to die. He's only weeks away. In fact, Lazarus's death is what convinces the religious leaders, "We've had enough. All the Jewish people are going to believe in him. We have to do something." And that something is put Jesus to death. In the present context, we also see another angle of Thomas's faith, his commitment to follow Jesus. This is the response of a true disciple. Just as Peter in John 6 sticks with Jesus even though he doesn't understand Jesus' discourse about his body and blood after the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, here Thomas is willing to go with Jesus even though he has a hunch it's going to mean danger for the Lord and for the 12. He is still concerned about Jesus' safety as well as his own, but he's committed to following Jesus as Lord and teacher. He's not understanding Jesus' words about Lazarus, but despite his confusion and lack of clarity, his is a faith commitment to the Lord, faith seeking understanding. Thomas is a godly example of a follower of Jesus at this point, following our Lord's call in Mark chapter 8, where he summoned his disciples and said, "If anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it." Let us not become lethargic or bewildered by hardship, brothers and sisters in Christ. But most of all, let us not wallow in unbelief, in the gall of bitterness when we face tragedy, but instead entrust ourselves to the Lord and look to him to further strengthen our trust in his saving mercy and in his providential care and love for us. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, our Heavenly Father, your beloved Son, befriended frail humans like us to make us your own people. Teach us to be like Jesus' dear friends from Bethany, that we might serve him faithfully like Martha, learn from him like Mary, so that we may be in union and know Christ in the power of his resurrection and in the fellowship of his sufferings. This we ask through Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son and our Lord. Amen. Our fellow Christians of other branches of Christ Church, and all who love our divine Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, are affectionately invited to the Lord's table. Let us pray for the state of Christ Church militant. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. To all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we must humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant us, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. You do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and earn love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways. Draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. As we pray, Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, Father. I, Son of our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul says. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John says. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Hope. To have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice, until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. Who in the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Amen.
Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for me.
Oh, Lamb of God, thou that takest
God for the people of God. Come, beloved, for all things have been made ready.
As I cry out to you,
I will trust in you. 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 Your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away. Precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. Remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, and live. When the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, and live. Final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, and go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and I live. you are my desire. No one else will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find the way, bring me back to you.
Now, as our Savior Christ has told us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee that thou dost vouchsafe to feed us who have duly received these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thine everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we must humbly beseech thee, O Lord, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Let us stand together for our closing hymn, God, my King, thy might confessing. Now let us hear the benediction. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.